Today, Emmanuela Radici, who's instructor at EPFL, École Polytechnique Fédérale de Lausanne, will present us deterministic particle approximation for non-local transport equations. So thank you, Emmanuela.
Thank you. So good afternoon, actually good morning to most of you. First of all, I would like to thank Katie and Simone for the very kind invitation. I'm very happy I had the chance to speak at this nice conference, and I'm as well very sorry that I could not participate in person. This is mainly due to some personal reasons, but at least we can take advantage of these hybrid format workshops and still feeling to be a participant. So what I'm gonna talk about today is basically the history of a deterministic particle scheme that we initially developed with Marco Di Francesco and Simone Fagioli, both from the University of L'Aquila, to study existence and uniqueness for a certain class of non-local transport equations that I'm gonna introduce in a moment. And then we will see how this scheme changed in time in slightly different settings, and also under different regularity assumptions on the potentials which were involved in these transport equations. So for now, let me already say that these kind of equations would model a wide range of phenomena where the common feature is that the agents would experience sort of pairwise attractive repulsive forces. And very often these pairwise interactions are coupled with some additional, let's say, repulsive effects, which may be modeled in the equation either by some diffusive terms or by some heat constraints, which would penalize the accumulation. And it's precisely this second effect that is kind of hidden here in the word nonlinear mobility. So first of all, I would like to tell you what I mean by transport equations with linear and nonlinear mobilities, and then we will see how this deterministic particle scheme applies to the case of nonlinear mobilities, which is chronologically the one that we studied first. And then we see also an application to the world of linear mobilities. And in the end, only if time allows, I would like to mention a further application to the theory, the different context, let's say, of opinion dynamics. So I didn't say this, but please feel free to interrupt me if you have questions, even during the talk, whenever you want. So let's start from a very standard situation. Let's assume to have n particles, which are located at position xi time t. And let's assume that these particles are interacting with each other thanks to some local interaction potential that we call w, that only depends for now on the relative distance between the particles. And since we mainly have in mind applications to contexts like the social biological ones, where inertial effects may be considered negligible, here we make this assumption. So the trajectories of these particles are well described by the solutions of this system of n ordinary differential equations, which clearly depend on the choice of the interaction potential. So this is very well known in the literature, and it is also very well known that this microscopic description allows for a macroscopic counterpart at the continuum level in terms of the density rho. And the dynamics is then described by this partial differential equation. And let's say the link between these two descriptions, the micro-macro, is very clear now. It has been studied a lot in the past literature. Here there is just a non-exhaustive list of references for that. It has been studied with different techniques and also under different regularity assumptions on the potential W. So it's not what I'm going to talk about here today. I just wanted to start from this example because I wanted to underline two features of this PDE, which will be of interest for this talk. The first one is that this equation shows a gradient flow structure with respect to the standard Bassestein distance. So in particular, tools coming from the gradient flow theory are available here, for example, JKO schemes, energy estimates, and so on. The second feature is the mobility part, which is, roughly speaking, this term here that you have inside the divergence before the gradient, or better, the first variation of the energy functional, is a linear function of the density. So in particular, it's the identity in this case. So keep in mind these two things, gradient flows and linear mobility. So what happens when the potential is attractive, for example, is that the particle clearly tend to concentrate. And so in terms of the macroscopic density, this rho can actually blow up. And this may happen even in finite time. In this last reference here, there is an explicit example of a singular potential where the blow up occurs in finite time. So if you want to prevent this overcrowding effect, then one of the possibilities is to go to modify the mobility, okay, by inserting an extra velocity term that would decrease where the concentration is higher and increase where the concentration is lower. So it would be a function of the density, a function v of the density, decreasing. And in general, it will have compact support because the idea is that there is a maximal threshold, a maximal value for the density allowed by the system, that as soon as you reach this maximal value, the evolution then will freeze. So you cannot go beyond this threshold. So for example, for the rest of the talk, if you want, you can imagine that this velocity term has precisely this shape. This is the standard choice in chemotaxis models. It's the positive part of one minus rho. So here the saturation is for the threshold is one, for example. And so at least at the continuum level, it is clear how the equation would look like. Your mobility part is now given by the product of rho with this velocity function, which is a function of the density. So in general, it's not linear, a linear function of the density anymore. So what we did the first time with Di Francesco and Fagioli was to consider the scalar version of this PDE in the case of symmetric attractive potentials, smooth enough, so basically C2 with bounded second derivatives, at least locally. And what we wanted to do was to provide a suitable deterministic particle scheme for which it was possible to reconstruct some discrete approximations of the macroscopic density that would eventually converge to a solution of the PDE. And now you see that actually this equation is different from the one we quoted at the beginning, because first of all, it's not a gradient flow anymore, or at least it's not a gradient flow with respect to Wasserstein. It would be a gradient flow with respect to weighted Wasserstein distance in terms of the where the weight is precisely the velocity term. But tools like the JKO schemes, for example, are not available anymore in this context. And the second thing is that you see that precisely because of the presence of this velocity term that depends locally on the density, if you want to pass to the limit in the equation, so when you want to approximate the solutions, you are not allowed to talk about weak approximations because of this V. This equation would pass to the limit only when you have some strong compactness, for example, in L1. So roughly speaking, if you want to talk about particles, you cannot use the empirical measures associated to the particles. Okay, first of all, because V evaluated in the empirical measures wouldn't make any sense, and also because then you cannot pass to the limit in the equation. So the things are two. The first one is finding a proper deterministic particle scheme, and the second is providing a way on how to construct discrete approximations of this density starting from the particle. And the idea here was to rely on the one-dimensional structure. So then you have your particles which are located on the real line. And the idea is to consider piecewise constant approximations of the density. In this way. So the Pitchfest constants are precisely constants in the interval between each pair of consecutive particles. And the constants are identified in such a way that the mass between two particles is precisely 1 over n. So the constant is calculated precisely in this way, 1 over n times the distance between the two consecutive particles. And it turned out that this choice of the particle scheme was good to provide piecewise constant reconstructions that would eventually converge strongly in L1 space-time to not a random weak solution, but to the unique entropy solution of this Cauchy problem, provided that the initial condition has some bounded variation, it's in L infinity, and has compact support. Okay, let's say here the crucial assumptions are the BV bound and the uniform bound, while the compact support can be relaxed because anyway, your potential is attractive, so you can get rid of this somehow. But for simplicity, let's assume that we have compact support. And just one word about this particle system. You see that the dynamics of the particle Xi is influenced by the position of all the other particles, clearly. And what happens is that the particles that are before Xi, so on the left, if you want, due to the attractivity of the potential, they are pushing the evolution of Xi backward. No? So the velocity term here has to be computed with respect to the density that the particle Xi sees backward, so the one constructed with respect to the position of the particle Xi minus 1. While the opposite happens for the particles which are located after Xi. So those particles will be pushing the evolution of Xi forward. And so in this case, the velocity term has to be evaluated with respect to the discrete density that sees the position of the particle Xi plus 1. So two words about
the question.
Yes. But I'm very sorry, I cannot hear you.
Could you please go back to the previous slide?
Yes.
Okay, so my understanding is that these particles are ordered in a sense that Xi is always at the left side of Xi plus 1.
I'm going to say this in a moment.
Is that ordering preserved during the dynamics?
This is what I was going to say. Yes, it's preserved. Yeah. You're welcome. As I said, thank you for the question, by the way. What we can prove is that thanks to the L infinity bound on the initial datum, is that there is a minimal distance between the particles that can never be violated. Okay. So this minimal distance is uniquely determined by the L infinity bound on the initial datum, because of the presence of the velocity term, as soon as the two particles reach this minimal distance, then they have to stop. Their evolution stops and they can only move in the other direction. Okay. So the consequence of this is that clearly the particles can never collide or switch position. So the initial order of the particles is maintained during the whole evolution. And because of the constraint that we have, that the mass between two particles has to be fixed, the fixed value 1 over n, then we have also an upper bound, a uniform upper bound on the piecewise constants, okay, in terms of the L infinity norm of the initial datum. Okay, and so this allows us to define the piecewise constant to have well-defined piecewise constants, because then this interval here between the two consecutive particles always have a strictly positive measure, and these coefficients never blow up for every time. And what we can prove is that this sequence is actually strongly compact in L1 space-time. And this is not something straightforward because L1 oscillations in time may behave pretty bad. What we can do instead is we can use a smart generalization of the Aubin-Lyon compactness argument that is due to Rossi and Savaret, which basically says that if you are able to control oscillations in space in some stronger sense, stronger than L1, then it's enough to control oscillations in time in a weaker topology. So in our case, we can find uniform estimates on the total variations of the piecewise constant and uniform estimates on the support. Okay, this bound is for free because we started from an initial datum that was that had compact support, and then we have an aggregative potential, so it's very intuitive that this bound holds. But this bound, the BV bound in particular, allows us to estimate oscillations in time with respect to the vastest N1 topology. Here we can find Lipschitz continuity with respect to vastest N1. And the combination of these two things together is implying the strong L1 compactness space-time. Then completely independently, we can prove that the piecewise constants are solved an approximated version of the Kruskov entropy inequality up to some error that is actually vanishing when the number of particles go to infinity. So applying the compactness result of the previous step, we can pass to the limit this approximated entropy inequality. And for the limit density rho, what we have is the clean Kruskov entropy condition. Okay, so in particular, the limit density is an entropy solution of the problem. And then the uniqueness comes from a suitable generalization of a stability result that was done by Carson and Risebro for the entropy inequalities that holds for fluxes that of our form. Okay. Then what happened is that with Simone Fagioli, we wanted to add some diffusion to the problem. And actually, fortunately, adding the diffusion makes things worse because clearly the diffusion is playing against the bound, the uniform bound on the supports. So in order to make the whole machinery work again, we had to impose a priori to fix our evolution inside a bounded box. So we have this very restrictive assumption here where the whole evolution has to happen in a bounded box with zero velocity boundary condition. And we also have a technical assumption on the initial datum that has to be strictly far from zero, so had no vacuum regions. And in this setting, we are allowed to consider, okay, the same class of non-local interaction potentials and diffusions which may be strongly degenerate. This is quite a good thing because in general, existence results for strongly degenerate diffusions are hard to achieve while we can manage to get them. What we can do is to still prove that our sequence of piecewise constants, this time coming from this system of particles, the part related to the non-local interaction is exactly the same as before, while the part related to the diffusive term is has precisely this expression that is not new. We use the same discretization that was introduced by Giovanni Russo and Giuseppe Toscani and Loren Goss in two different papers, mainly for numerical purposes. And still we get the convergence strongly in L1 to the unique solution of this problem. Then there is a more recent result of Marco Di Francesco with his PhD student, Graziano Stivaletta, where they deal with the case of the external potential with this regularity and with some prescribed regime. So it's either positive, negative, or repulsive or attractive. And for each case, they provide the suitable choice of the particle scheme, the deterministic particle scheme that eventually would still give the strong L1 compactness for the piecewise constants related to in each different case to the particles. And finally, this summer, in two completely independent works, I'm quoting first this one because it's the one that appeared first in on archive. We studied the coupled case with the non-local interaction and the external potential. So in this first paper, that is due to Simone Fagioli and Oliver Tse, they were more interested in the gradient flow structure of the equation. They were exploiting some energy dissipation inequalities, and basically what they can do is the following. They can consider potentials which are more general. Let's say the external potential has to be C2 and the derivative has to have some linear growth at infinity, while the non-local interaction is a symmetric potential which is either regular with linear growth at infinity, sorry, where the derivative has linear growth at infinity, or it's only Lipschitz at the origin, but it has to have this precise shape that is what they call Newtonian potential. So in this setting, they can prove that the many particle limit of, so the piecewise constants, if you want, reconstructed by this different deterministic particle scheme that I'm gonna comment in a second, will actually converge. They have a compactness argument that, as I said, relies more on the energy dissipation balance. And they can prove that the piecewise constants converge to their notion of gradient flow solution. And when W has this enjoys these regularities, one, at least one of the two, they can prove that the limit gradient flow solution is actually corresponded precisely to the unique entropy solution of the problem. And here the particle system is different from the one we had before, because basically the main difference stays in the fact that they compute the velocity term only once. They look first at the total contribution of the position of the particles. So they compute the velocity field given by all the other particles. And clearly the sign of the total contribution is giving a hint on what would be the direction of the dynamics of the particle Xi. So if the total sign is positive, then this means that the particle Xi would like to move forward. And so in this case, the velocity has to be computed with respect to the forward reconstruction of the density. While if the total contribution is negative, then the opposite, the Xi would like to move backward, and so the velocity term has to be evaluated with respect to the position of Xi minus one. Okay, while in the other paper that I did with Federico Stra, we were not interested in the gradient flow structure. We found a way basically to still prove the compactness argument Alaoban-Lyon. And more in particular, we found a way how to prove the approximated version of the entropy inequality for a very general class of potentials. We can allow the potentials, the local interactions and the external potential to depend on time in a wild way, just L1. We can allow we don't need to impose the symmetry on the interactions, and we can have also Lipschitz singular non-local interaction potentials without prescribing the Newtonian shape at the origin. And what we do, we study two different deterministic particle schemes. The first one is what we call sample scheme, is exactly the one considered by Fagioli and Tse, while the second one is an integrated version. And so we will refer to that as the integrated particle scheme. And we study the sequence of piecewise constant reconstructions coming from the particles of both the two schemes. And basically what we are able to prove is that the particles coming from the integrated scheme, they really enjoy, once again, the approximated version of the entropy inequality. And so they converge to the unique entropy solution. And on the other hand, the piecewise constant reconstruction coming from the sampled particles have to converge to the same thing. In the end, what we prove is this. So then by comparisons, we also get that the two schemes are converging to the same limit, which is the unique entropy solution. And a thing that I didn't write here explicitly is that we also can relax an assumption on the velocity term. We don't need to assume the velocity to have compact support anymore. We can consider also velocities which are decreasing to zero fast enough, but not having prescribed the fixed compact support. So in terms of the solution, this means that the solution can technically blow up, but only in infinita, so when time goes to infinity. And here I have some simulations that I wanted to show, which are courtesy of Simone Fagioli and Federico Stra. So this first one shows the particle methods as the first one introduced with Di Francesco and Fagioli, shows the particle method as a numerical scheme in comparison with Godunov, and you see that this particle method detects the shocks much better than Godunov. And then here I have an example where the weak solutions are non-unique for the case of the purely attractive regime. Here, for I don't know if you notice at the beginning, we start from an initial configuration which is given by two peaks of mass 1/2, which are separated, and they have height 1. We consider as velocity term the standard positive part of 1 minus rho. And as an aggregative potential, we have the Gaussian, so the convex Gaussian. And here what happens is that the initial configuration is actually a weak stationary solution for the problem, but it's not the entropic one. The entropic one is precisely the one detected by the particles, where the particles then will move towards the barycenter and will make the two peaks collide in the middle in a unique peak of mass one. Then here I have a simulation with the diffusion also, a strongly degenerate diffusion. You see in the values between the two green lines in this horizontal strip, the diffusion is degenerate. And so you see that the profile of the reconstruction is very steep, while the regularizing effect of the diffusion is very evident outside the strip. And here I have some simulations with the new scheme that we developed with Federico Stra for some potentials which are time dependent. They are oscillating in time. And this is just to show that the scheme is very stable with respect to the number of particles. So here we had 80 particles and 240 particles, and the profile is already quite precise with 80 particles. This is just to convince you that there is no difference between the piecewise constant reconstructions coming from the sample scheme and the integrated one, at least in 1D and for the one species case. The two profile matches perfectly. While if you want to try the multi-species case, then the integrated scheme works better, it's more stable. And here we have a simulation with a velocity term that is that doesn't have compact support. It vanishes to zero, but it doesn't have compact support. And you can see precisely that there is the aggregation, but without a blow up in finite time. And finally, here I have I would like to show you a comparison between the new scheme and the old scheme. In one example where actually it seems that the new scheme is more stable with respect to the notion of entropy solution. Because in this case, we have the standard velocity, so the positive part of 1 minus rho, and an aggregative potential that is concave. We start from an initial condition, which is the same one that I mentioned before. So we have two peaks of mass 1/2 each and of height 1. In this case, the entropy solution is precisely the stationary solution. So the two peaks that do not move, they are the entropic solution. And you see that the new scheme detects immediately the entropy solution, independently on the number of particles. The new scheme is the one on the right. While the old scheme instead behaves differently. So in the limit, it will converge to the right entropy solution, to the two peaks. But as soon as the number of particles is finite, then you observe a sort of fake behavior of the particles. Because what happens is that, for example, this particle here feels the attraction of the particles coming from the other peak. Okay, and the local reconstruction of the density that from this particle that looks in this direction sees a very small value for the density, so a not saturated value, and so the velocity is not zero there, and so this particle will immediately move towards the second peak, and the, clearly the same happens for the first particle of the second peak with respect to the particle of the first peak. So for any fixed number of particles, you will immediately see that these two particles at least start moving after time zero. And so sooner or later, because all the other particles of the peaks will follow them, you will have a collision between the two peaks in the middle. But this collision will happen at some time that gets bigger and bigger depending on the number of particles. Okay, so in the limit, when the number goes to infinity, the particles go to infinity, then you don't see this behavior anymore. But as soon as the number is fixed, yes. Okay. And then, as promised, I wanted to mention something about the application of these schemes to the case with linear mobilities. So in particular, here we have to a gradient flow equation, if you want, that we studied with Sara Daneri and Eris Runa with a completely different motivation in mind. Actually, we wanted to study some qualitative properties of minimizers of a precise class of energy functionals, and we didn't manage. But the byproduct of that study was that we could solve the problem of adding the diffusion without the bounded box, and also with a very mild assumptions on the initial datum. And let me already say that result here is actually improving in the 1D case, a very interesting work of José Antonio Carrillo, Katy Craig, and Francesco Patacchini, which holds in any dimension in the multi-D case for equations of this form, so no local interactions plus diffusion, where they also were looking for a deterministic particle scheme, but they were using a completely different method, the blob method. And what they proved in their case was a weak convergence of the gradient flows. While in our case, we really wanted to get in the end the strong L1 compactness. Okay, this is just in 1D, but it's slightly bit stronger. And what we can do here is okay. We can take no local interactions, which are still just Lipschitz the origin and symmetric, and diffusions which are strictly monotone increasing with some additional, let's say, technical assumptions on the growth, but this is not very important. You can think that, for example, all porous medium diffusions are included in this class, and our initial datum will be a probability measure with finite first moment in an infinity, but without any bound on the total variation. And the other crucial assumption on the initial datum is that it has to have finite energy. Okay, the energy associated to the system evaluated at rho zero has to be finite. And then what we can do is that we can approximate this Cauchy problem on a sequence of tori with increasing size, and perform the many particle limit on each torus, okay, where the particle system is the one written here, which is the one you would expect. And what we have is that we have convergence of the many particle limit on each torus. So in the end, we have a sequence of limits that depends on the size of the torus, and we can make the standard comparison with the real line, so the we can see these limits as functions on the on something having support two times the size of the torus on the real line, and this sequence will eventually converge strongly in L1 to the solution of the problem here. And here the point is using the gradient flow structure. Okay, what is true is that since we start from an initial condition that has finite energy, then the corresponding problem on the torus, we can associate an energy to the problem on the torus. And what is true is that this sequence of energies, depending on the size of the torus, is gamma converging to the energy on the Fourier line itself. So if the first initial condition had finite energy, then we can provide the sequence of approximations of the initial condition having finite energy on the torus. And then what we can prove is this very interesting estimate on the energy. Basically the energy will remain bounded, uniformly bounded along the piecewise constants on the fixed torus. So we have this Gronwald type estimate. So the derivative in time of the energy is controlled by the size of the torus, which now is fixed, over the number of particles to the square root. Okay, but this n will increase while L remains fixed. So we have, as I said, a uniform bound on the energy for the whole evolution on the single torus. And this is enough actually to provide two very important things. The first one is a maximum principle for the piecewise constants, which now is not granted anymore because there is no velocity. We don't have any more than nonlinear mobility. Okay, so actually what we can consider are also what we were really interested in were local interaction potentials, which would be aggregating at short scales and repulsive at longer scales. So you would expect dough ups. But still, this bound on the energy tells you, okay, this is not possible. And also the bound on the energy is giving a nice bound, basically a bound on uniform bound on the discretized version of the W12 norm of this sequence, which is the sequence of the diffusion evaluated on the piecewise constant. And so one can apply the compactness argument of Oben-Leon for this sequence, the phi of rho Ln, and obtain L1 compactness for this sequence. And so thanks to the monotonicity of the diffusion phi and the uniform bound, the infinity bound on the piecewise constant, then one can deduce also the L1 compactness for the piecewise constant itself on the torus. And then, as I said, you pass to the limit in the number of particles inside the torus, you get your limit density, and the sequence of the limit densities is actually converging in appropriate sense on the whole real line to the solution of the problem. And as I said, I just wanted to quote very briefly an application to the theory of opinion dynamics. So I will not comment too much on this. I just wanted to show you this standard model in opinion dynamics, where you see the situation is very similar to the one that I described at the beginning with Simone Fagioli. Okay, actually here we have a local term, which is not given by a convolution, but by something similar. And we have a diffusive term where basically we have a non-homogeneous mobility in space. The mobility is linear with respect to the density, but it's non-homogeneous with respect to the space variable. Here, the space variable is what is mimicking the opinions, okay? And the bounded interval here is the full range of opinions that you can have from the between the two extreme ones. And this diffusive, non-homogeneous mobility, so this is capital D, is what models the diffusion of the single opinion, while the non-local term is what is modeling the local relevance of the compromise. And still, we can find a suitable deterministic particle scheme, which is actually computed in the same way as we had the other one in the case that I described before. So it's consistent to the choice. And what we can prove is that still we can approximate a strong linear one the solutions. And I wanted to show you this application to opinion dynamics because for this case, precisely because we don't have the nonlinear mobilities, we can consider systems of different populations because the equations are completely decoupled. And it was time of elections in Italy when we did this work together. And so we tried to do some numerics to study the dynamics of a population of followers and of two parties, the red party and the blue party that you see here. They're all able to diffuse. And the followers in particular, they interact with each other and also with the red party and the blue party, while the two parties, they only interact with themselves and with the other party. Mm-hmm. And this is an example of the evolution of the opinions of the followers. And the funny thing is that we could even couple this this study with a further population of fake agents, which is called the population of trolls, which can be seen as, if you want, as the a population of let's say fake accounts on the social networks. So this population is owned by one of the two parties, and so it cannot diffuse. It cannot interact with anyone else. Only the agents of the blue party. Okay. And here there are some interesting simulations where we fix the mass of the followers of the red party on the blue party, and we just increase, we consider three different cases where we increase the mass of the trolls. And already in this first case, where the sum of the mass of the blue party and the trolls is smaller than the mass of the red party, you see that the evolution of the opinion of the followers is anyway already shifted towards the ideas of the blue party, okay? And the more, the bigger the mass of the trolls is, the more evident is this shifting. Okay, maybe from this slide, you can see it better. Okay, this is compared with respect to the symmetric evolution. Okay, this was just for fun. Let me conclude by saying that there are still many open problems related to these deterministic particle schemes. One of them is studying the case of the diffusion with nonlinear mobility without prescribing the bounded box. The other one is clearly to consider a bigger class of non-local interaction potentials, eventually more singular at the origin, for example, all of Lennard-Jones type, without the linear mobility, with or without. And then we would like really to study the case of the multi-species case in 1D, and then also to generalize this approach to higher dimensions, maybe starting from networks, which seems more feasible, and then go to higher dimensions. Okay, with this I conclude. I'm very sorry I went a bit over time, and I thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Emanuela, for the very nice talk and simulations. Do we have questions for Emanuela?
Hi, thank you. This was very, very interesting. I have a sort of extension question. Mm-hmm. So all the mobilities that you considered, they're local in the density, right?
Yes.
So what if you would like to consider things that depend through integrals on the density or moments, for example?
Uh-huh. Okay. I confess I never thought about this. Thank you for the question. Okay. Let's say
I was just wondering if you had thought about it.
No, I did not. But I see one problem at first. But it probably depends on how you want to define these mobilities now. That is the maximum principle. Okay, you want to have the maximum principle. So probably this already restricts the kind of terms that you can consider somehow. But maybe you had in mind something different. Sorry.
Yeah, specifically, for example, if you put the variance there,
uh-huh.
variance of the density. So that's very specific and it's still linear in raw.
Okay. No, okay, I don't
want to take too much time. I just wanted to.
Okay, no, I didn't think about this, but it's very interesting. Thank you for the question. I wouldn't answer now because I don't know.
Okay, one more question and then.
Thanks a lot. I really like your talk. So my understanding is that the biggest obstacle to extend to higher dimension is that you really need that ordering between particles. Is that right?
Yes. Let's say it's not that we need a order. We need to know how to reconstruct the piecewise affine approximations there. So one idea, for example, in 2D can be to consider Voronoi cells and the body center let's say locate the particles at the body centers of the Voronoi cells. But since our this argument is continuous in time, then I don't know whether also the there is a univocally defined way to see how the Voronoi cells would evolve in time. And this is one of the things that I'm scares me in higher dimensions. And also, then the velocity would be calculated exactly at the at the Voronoi cells of the particle. I don't know if I answered your question in this term.
Thanks a lot, yeah.
Thank you, Emanuela. I think we unfortunately have to stop here to keep the schedule. Thank but thanks a lot for the talk.
Thank you very much. I want to start. Thanks.